All right, joining us now on Hot Copy, Attorney Barry Gutierrez, spokesperson of Vice President Leni Robredo. Good morning to you, Barry.
Morning, Karen. Happy to be here.
All right. I know yesterday you were already interviewed and you had said that an apology is unnecessary, although you accept it. Sabi mo pa nga matatanda na kayo, it's a few days to go bago ang election, and you'd like to focus on that. But let me ask you first and foremost, you have Manila Mayor Isko Moreno, who is standing by his call. How does this affect the efforts for unity for the opposition as a whole, Barry?
Well, the efforts for unity to begin with always required some measure of commitment on the part of the people concerned to give way. Because obviously, there can only be one candidate that you will be uniting around. So it seems very clear now, at least from the three gentlemen who attended the press conference last Sunday, that they don't seem to be inclined to further pursue any conversation about unity. So for now, at least insofar as they are concerned, I don't think they will be involved in any further conversations. On our end, we have been focusing on our own campaign since October. Mm-hmm. VP Leni has been very clear in saying that she feels that the tandem she formed with Senator Kiko Pangilinan is the tandem that we should be campaigning for and fighting for till the end. So while we remain open to possible conversations on unity in the remaining 19 days until Election Day, it seems that the space for that has narrowed because of the events of Easter Sunday.
Okay. Now, Barry, I'm curious. Some have said that isn't this... wouldn't one consider this a failure on the part of the vice president? In other words, she did try to speak with them, she tried to unite them, and yet you have very scathing remarks about her character. She can't be trusted, she fooled us in the press conference. Doesn't this reflect on her leadership efforts in any way? Whereas you have Mr. Marcos and Ms. Sara Duterte, who are very united, and they kept their base.
If anything, I think it's a reflection more on the attitudes of the gentleman who spoke last Sunday. To be clear, Karen, the efforts of the vice president to talk to them and to try to get them all under one tent, they all happened prior to her declaration on October 7 of last year. So while we accept that, well, it's unfortunate that particular conversation did not really lead to the broader unity she was pursuing at that point, mm-mm, since then, you know, it's become a matter of, well, people who are willing, if you still want to talk and join together, then you can. But given that from their statements last Sunday, they don't seem to be open to it at all anymore. And two, they seem to be still nursing some hurts from what transpired months before. I don't think that's a reflection anymore on the vice president's efforts. That's really more a reflection on their attitude to begin with, which I think gives us a clue as to why the original talks did not go anywhere in the first place.
Okay. Now, Barry, let's set the record straight. Were there really formal withdrawal offers made from your camp with the vice president's go signal? Or were these efforts just from allies, liaisons who wanted to make the effort on their own? Some have said there was money being offered. How true is this? Is it official coming from the vice president's camp?
We've answered this several times before, and to be very clear, there have been no active efforts on our end to actually talk to any candidate, much less ask them to withdraw. Mm-hmm. Certainly, not money was never ever on the table. Mm-hmm. And in fact, if you look at their statements on the supposed talks, only one name was mentioned, Mayor June Simon. And we've already clarified that Mayor June Simon does not speak for the campaign and is not authorized to actually speak for the campaign. And whatever conversation he was pursuing, that was purely his own initiative and purely on his own, that was his own call. But aside from that name, No other names have been mentioned. No other person has been identified as actually spearheading the supposed effort. So we are actually surprised at the insistence of some of these candidates that it was VP Leni who was asking them to withdraw. She never did anything. And in fact, in all of her public statements, she has been very, very clear. We are no longer pursuing active efforts in this regard. Although we remain open to having conversations if, you know, people will talk to us.
Mm-mm. All right. Now let's talk about the campaign strategy as a whole. Juan Cebu has recently endorsed the candidacy of Mr. Marcos, and we do know the role that Cebu plays in presidential elections. They're able to deliver at least 2 million solid votes once a province or once Cebu carries them. Overall, how are you seeing this to affect the vice president's chances of even beating Mr. Marcos?
Well, you know, we're not too concerned. And the reason for that is we never really factored in as part of our general strategy from the beginning endorsements coming from local officials. We knew that running as opposition, running not as the official candidate of the administration, would already put us at a disadvantage insofar as local endorsements are concerned. This is familiar terrain for VP Leni. When she ran for Congresswoman of the 3rd District of Camarines Sur, she was in the same position. She was running against the incumbent. She did not have a single endorsement from any of her mayors. So her strategy at that point, which is the strategy we have adopted from the start here, is go directly to the people. And so far, we feel that that is a strategy that has paid off. Even in places where, in provinces where we do not have local government support, the outpouring of ordinary people coming to her rallies, volunteering to campaign for her, has been tremendous. Yesterday in Bataan, we did not have the support of the local government, but we had 65,000 people from Bataan coming to her rally, expressing their support. And after she left, they continue to actually campaign for her house to house, conversations within their own networks, and so on. And that's really been the approach. So while we are happy when local officials come forward to say that they are supporting VP Leni or supporting the tandem, that's on top of the strategy that we are already pursuing.
Okay. Are there areas at this point that you're considering are the vice president's bailiwicks?
Well, obviously, Bicol will be her biggest bailiwick. In 2016, she was running in a field with several candidates from the Bicol region, and yet she was able to garner upwards of 60-70%. In that area. Now that she is running as the sole Biculano for president, we expect that that percentage will improve. So definitely, we expect much from her home region in terms of vote delivery. Looking at areas where she also did well last election, you have Western Visayas. Considering that in Western Visayas, it's one of the few places where strong local government support has actually partnered with a strong grassroots support. So again, these are two areas where we expect the vice president will get a lot of support for on May 9.
How does your camp explain the results of the recent surveys with the vice president showing in NCR, for example, where you have Mr. Marcos at a tremendous lead, and yet you have Robredo's rallies, attracting that much people?
Well, one of the things that we have had to struggle with, not just from the start of the campaign, but over the last 6 years, has been the massive disinformation effort targeting the vice president on social media. And in urban centers like Metro Manila, this has had the most effect because people in urban centers tend to spend the most amount of time online, on Facebook, on Twitter, YouTube, all these other platforms. And we have had really to work double time to overcome the disinformation wall, as I call it, that they have built around the vice president. People really have very, very flawed opinions about what she has done, what she stands for, what she has said, and so on and so forth. So part of the TAC has always been engage, ideally outside of social media, bring out the truth, talk to people about who the vice president really is. Mm-hmm. And I think that the recent surge in her numbers in all of the surveys is proof positive that this is an approach that is slowly working. Mm-hmm. Now, with 19 days to go until the until election day, this is really something that we are working double time on. And hopefully, her numbers will continue to increase in areas like Metro Manila and other urban centers around the country.
Okay. Barry, has your team ever discovered the true person behind that supposed sex video linking the vice president's daughter?
No. the problem with anonymity on social media is that it's very, very difficult to actually find out the true identities of people posting behind anonymous accounts. At first, PNP said that they would investigate, but now they're asking for us to file a formal complaint. Mm-mm. And the vice president has already... The lawyers are looking into it. Mm-hmm. We have a large team of lawyers, and they are pursuing that particular attack. But as VP Leni said, para sa kampanya, mag-focus na lang tayo doon sa importante. We look at this really as yet another attempt to try and derail the momentum we have managed to generate over the last few weeks. And we don't want to be sidetracked by it. We have a team looking into it. They will pursue it. But insofar as the VP herself and the main campaign is concerned, we will utilize every second of the remaining 19 days to actually push our message, continue what we have been doing, and raise our numbers all the way up to election day.
Now, many stars have come out to support Vice President Robredo. Do you believe that can be convertible into votes? I've heard some analysts say that stars are one thing, but mayors, kingpins, local officials are the ones that really deliver, and they call it command voting on the day itself. So what, based on, I think you've seen enough in terms of the vice president running. Are you seeing this to, have a big conversion on election day?
The conversion doesn't come in the form of command votes, obviously. Command votes are one thing. That's a completely different phenomenon. But conversion in terms of persuasion, I think that the celebrity endorsers and the proxies of the VP, her daughters, for example, going house to house, going to markets, talking to people face to face, I think that's where the conversion happens. As I said earlier, I think the biggest problem we have had to confront over the last 6 months has been getting past all the disinformation that social media has generated around the vice president. And the best way we have found to get around that is, real conversations. Take the fight, take the conversation outside of social media. So if people talk face to face, if people talk to people that they know within their own networks, then it's possible for conversion to happen, and we've seen that the huge leaps in the vice president's numbers are proof positive that this is an approach that actually works.
Uh-oh.
And the celebrity endorsers getting on that train, also going house to house, I think is a huge boost to these efforts.
Okay, Barry, the analysis that this 22-24% of Leni Robredo, that's the cap, that's it. They say she can't go any higher than that.
Well, when we were at 20, they said the cap was 20. Now we're at 24, they say the cap was 24. I don't think so. I think that there are enough studies to indicate that she can go much higher, mid-30s, high-30s, low-40s. And it's
you
just a matter
that?
Of...
You believe you have enough time for that?
Well, that's really the big question. It's now a question of effort versus time. But I think that in the remaining 3 weeks, the efforts that have so far already been done will continue to snowball. Because after all, this is not a linear progression. You're talking about an exponential progression here. Every person that gets convinced also campaigns. So two people become four, become, you know, eight, and so on. So it's really going to accelerate, and we feel that 3 weeks is enough time to actually catch up.
Okay, because you have Mr. Marcos at least at a lead of 30%. I mean, do you still believe that you can break that?
Well, you have to remember that the 30% is anchored on surveys that were conducted in March. So that was 2 months from the election. That's one of the problems we have right now. Surveys come out a month later. They talk about things that were that happened a month ago, that were true a month ago. It's a snapshot from a month back. More recent surveys I have seen, some even indicate that the gap is much narrower. Maybe as narrow
is
as 15%. So well, of course, they will say, well, you know, surveys are surveys, and you know, every survey says it's a different thing. But I think that a more realistic range will be somewhere between 15 to maybe 20-25%, and that's certainly doable in the in what remains of the time for the campaign.
Okay, I'm curious, will the vice president be attending the last town hall debate that the COMELEC is sponsoring this Sunday?
Yes, we've committed to actually attending all the COMELEC debates. There have been two so far.
And does that help her? I wanted to ask you, strategically, does that help her? Because the Marcos camp has done the math, and they felt that with so many candidates, there's not enough time to really present your platform. So they feel that it's not a plus to Mr. Marcos. He'd rather spend his time really campaigning outdoors. But I'm curious, do you believe that these debates have helped the vice president?
Well, I think that the debates are actually a very, very good example of their approach to leadership. The VP does not go to the debates because she thinks that they will help her. She goes to the debates because she thinks that it's her responsibility to actually go to the debate, participate, let the people know about her platforms, answer questions that they think are important to be answered, and so on. Mr. Marcos looks at it as, well, wala akong magiging benefit dyan, so hindi ko gagawin. So that's the difference. From the start, our perspective on the debate, it was not whether or not meron ba tayo makukuhang boto dito, but whether it is the responsible thing to do for a candidate. Because after all, there will be far harder challenges as President of the Republic than, you know, going to a debate. So kung ngayon pa lang hindi ka na willing na nagawin, I think that's a reflection of the kind of leader you will be. And the VP, more than anything else, wants to demonstrate this early on the kind of leader she will be.
Okay, I'm curious, April 23, I read a schedule on Twitter. Is that pushing through this supposedly Makati rally on the 23rd?
There's the 23rd is the schedule for this big, well, it's a birthday rally, although the VP does not want to call it that. It's her birthday on the 23rd. So there will be a big rally on along Makapagal Avenue in Pasay. There are groups in Makati, the volunteer groups that will assemble in Makati and then march, travel to the final venue in Pasay.
Yun, Barry, anong reaction mo? Sinasabi ng ilan, marami ang nakikita sa crowds ni VP Leni, pero pare-parehong tao lang daw. Yung nasa Pasig, yun din ang pupunta sa Makati, yun din ang pumupunta sa ibang lugar.
Well, while it may be true that particularly for Metro Manila, there might be people who will go to multiple rallies, I think that the huge numbers themselves tell you that it's more than just a small core of people. Particularly if you look at the rallies in Mindanao, in the Visayas, in northern Luzon, it's not just it's definitely not just the same 40,000 people flying everywhere. Clearly, wherever she goes, there's really a strong groundswell of support. And I'll remind everyone, it's not just the rallies. It's what happens before and after the rallies, the house-to-house campaigns, the grassroots campaign that volunteers do. That happens virtually 24/7 and has been happening for the past few months. So I don't think anymore that it can be denied that this is not just a small core, but really a nationwide grassroots movement which has coalesced around the vice president's candidacy for the presidency.
Okay. Now, before we end, I wanted to ask you about Senator Manny Pacquiao. Of course, many have said that it's too late to withdraw at this point. It's a few days to go. Even Buddy Zamora said that. But then he also said, if you look at the body language of VP Leni and Manny Pacquiao, you'll see that they're warm towards each other in the debates. He said that on the show. Are you giving up on Manny Pacquiao at this point? Or does the vice president believe that there's still a possibility to unite or to win Manny Pacquiao over to your side?
Well, it's true that they really have a good relationship, and I think they have a lot of respect and affection for each other. But, you know, at this point, as we've said, the priority is really our own campaign. But we remain very open to any conversations. But at the end of the day, the decision has to be with Senator Manny. We respect the statements that his camp has issued. We respect ultimately whatever decision he makes. So we'll see. 19 days, still a long time, and still a lot can happen.
All right. Anything you want to add, Barry, before we go?
Well, just one last thing. Everywhere that I have gone over the past few days, I've been asked about surveys. And, you know, one thing that I want to emphasize is that, you know, surveys are a snapshot. They are not an indication of inevitability. If anything, the sequence of snapshots we have seen over the past few weeks indicates that the PP's numbers are going up. The momentum is with her. And we are very, very confident going into the last 19 days until Election Day that that momentum will carry her forward to a victory on May 9th.
All right. On that note, thank you very much, Mr. Barry Gutierrez. Good luck with the vice president's campaign.
Thank you very much, Karen. Always a pleasure to be here. And stay safe.